We didn't know it then, but we were reading the first chapter of the Bible.
There was something so creepy and so different about it.
The picture that it paints, their music and just Maynard's vocals, and it puts you in a different place.
This changed, in my opinion, changed the face of heavy music. They transcended every genre that you heard in what made this band up.
Undertow was an instant favorite for me when it came out. You know, the music is just so complex and dark and eerie and drenched with emotion. And sonically, just really thunderous. You know, Sylvia Massey, the producer, she did a fantastic job with it. It's one of my favorite sounding records ever, and quite possibly one of the most unique sounding records, to the point where Tool themselves have never actually replicated it again.
Everything about it, the songwriting, the lyrics are sheer poetry, I think. The musicianship, the performances, the way that it's deceptively simple.
It was metal, but with cool mix of prog in there as well. And it was also extremely arty. Like, the videos were arty, the packaging was arty, everything was super arty. And it's almost like, if everybody in the pack is going left, screw it, we're gonna go right.
They are totally on another level. They're not just singing rock songs about sex, drugs, and rock and roll. These guys are singing about deep, disturbing shit.
There's no choice but to confront you, to engage you, to erase you.
When you heard Undertow, you just were like, oh, this is real anger. This is real angst. This is real disgust with society.
And it was all contained in this really dark and artistic aesthetic. You know, the packaging scared the shit out of me as a kid. And the videos were just like the most monumental thing I saw.
The packaging really freaked me out as a young kid. Like, them like with their mouths stretched open and like pinned open, and the big fat naked woman and all that stuff. I was like, these guys are fucked up, man. There's no doubt in my mind about that.
They had done a showcase for a bunch of labels, and the big buzz around LA was this band Tool. So I went to see them, and I thought the band was good, but Maynard, the frontman, was phenomenal. I mean, he was absolutely on fire. You could tell this guy was going to be a massive star. And then when the first record came out, same thing. You're like, whoa, this is another one of these game changers where it sounds completely different from anything that else is out there. They're really great. I saw them live on that first tour several times, and they're absolutely phenomenal band, and Maynard was just on fire.
Maynard's voice is just, at this point, he's so angry and just so full of this like dark energy. I've never really heard anything that really deep and disturbing in music that I enjoyed so much.
Maynard was an obvious rock star, not because he tried to be like on Sunset Strip with Nikki Sixx or something, because he was this eccentric weirdo, you know, who had a lot to say artistically.
He's my favorite poet, you know? He has a way of putting words and melodies together that just speak volumes. And, you know, you find yourself constantly reciting his lyrics, whether you actually agree with them or, you know, even understand them.
He always finds really succinct and beautiful and evocative images to hit just the right emotion. That maybe you know exactly what he's talking about and maybe you don't, but you now feel like that song relates to you. His metaphors are applicable in a lot of different situations.
Outside of the progressions they had and you know, the sonically what they created musically, his voice to me makes the band what they are.
Maynard is like the anti-frontman. Like, he just does not give a shit. He plays at their live shows. He plays in the back of the stage, sometimes behind a scrim. You can't even see him. There's no spotlights on him. He mocks the audience, openly makes fun of Tool fans. You know, I think like he's the antithesis of a frontman, and by being so is kind of like the ultimate frontman.
I remember when the track Sober broke and it just spread like wildfire. You know, he's all over radio, not just metal radio, all over MTV, Headbangers Ball, regular rotation. And it was just so captivating and different that you couldn't look away if you tried.
When I first saw the video for Sober on MTV, I was like, what is this?
It looks great. It totally holds up. It's one of all-time great videos. And that's obviously a testament to Adam Jones, who was a visual designer. They needed to complement their style, and they did it visually by having those just dark, demented videos with the message. And it's very, sometimes it was sad, sometimes it was compelling, sometimes it was shocking and disturbing, but overall, still equally as beautiful.
It preceded my exposure to like all the blood and guts and extremity of you know, what would come in my life with death metal. So, you know, like seeing that and shit at the time was just like so extreme and like, so like, wow, these guys are like nothing else, man.
They're one of those bands that pretty much from the word go made amazing music videos, and they're the only band I know whose live show is so good that the members don't even have to move or be visible.
MTV was thriving at the time, and their videos were so artistic and unique, and it was a band that, like, you, when they got massive, it was like, yeah, the good guys won, you know? This is cool that this happened.
You know, I think Tool was always a band and will always be a band that has something for everyone. You know, even back in 93, there was jazz students in my school who would dissect Danny Carey's drum parts. And these were kids who knew nothing about the metal scene.
It was okay to like them if you were into metal, and it was okay to like them if you were into alternative or grunge or whatever. And I think that's really a large part of their success.
Going to an arena to see a Tool show, it's not your typical metal show. You're gonna see metalheads, sure, but you see a lot of like frat dudes and bros and just like families, really, and like a lot of people like Tool.
It was like one of those times in history where a band truly, like, seems like it was just a mistake that they got massive, you know? And then it's like they're just a staple, and like they're the kind of band that like their fans just stay with them forever. They could take 10 years off and like still people care. And
Tool are like the Stanley Kubrick of metal. They like pop out once every 78 years and do something brilliant and go away.
When you have somebody like Tool who comes in, it's so musically legitimate and it's so emotionally legitimate, it kind of anchors that whole time period.